Good morning, everyone. Good morning and welcome to Pray First. It is your Friday morning edition and I get to be here with you this morning. I'm going to wait for a couple minutes as people come on in and just welcome them as they come in. So if you're coming in, please make sure you're saying hi to one another, letting me know how you guys are doing this glorious Friday morning. It is Friday. It's super exciting. It is a little muggy outside, which it usually is, but I still wanted to come for you outside. I got up a little later this morning, enjoying my coffee, thinking about what I get to say to you guys this morning. I love that we're in the Bible Project 21, because that means we are reading through the Bible, and I want you guys to enjoy it. I want you guys to realize how much fun and how rich it is to read the Bible in different versions. And since we're reading it in the Message version, oh my goodness, it is so much, it's so different. It brings new things to light for me. So good morning, Tawana. Good morning, Sean. Good morning, Barbie. Good morning, Bonnie. How are you guys all doing this morning? I think I saw Stephanie May. I saw your name pop up this morning. Good morning to you and Pat and Sarah. Hope you guys are all having a fantastic day. Hey, Anita, I'm so glad you can join us live. Good morning, Lana. How are you doing? Oh, I see a... Oh, no. JoJo has a tummy bug. Yes, I will be praying for him. And speaking of which, go ahead and hashtag if you do have people that you know that are feeling sick. My child, Leah, is at home sick today. She's going to be... All of her friends are really sick, and all of her friends have gotten tested for COVID, and it's all negative. It seems to be this other bug that's going around. Apparently, RSV is going around right now, even in the older kids, which surprised me. So she is sleeping in. She says she doesn't feel that bad, but just with everyone so concerned with people being sick, she's like, my throat's hurting. She goes, I think I'm just going to take today, sleep even more so, because she left a little early yesterday. So anyways, if your child is not feeling good, if you're not feeling good, if you know someone that's not feeling good and you would like prayers, please let us know. And yes, I will be praying for JoJo. I think the tummy bug is one of the worst. All right, so as I'm getting ready this morning and I'm thinking, wow, I'm excited. Today is my day off. As soon as I come and talk with you guys this morning, which is one of my favorite things to do, I'll be honest with you. I was thinking, I wonder what everyone else does. Okay, so my job outside of being a mom and a wife is I am an executive pastor over at Cross Point Church, and that's how I got to get to know Pastor Doug, and that's why I get the lovely opportunity to get to know you guys. So I am curious. I saw someone post this on their Facebook page, and I thought it was curious. So what do you guys do for a living? I'm just curious. Let's get to know each other a little bit more. Like, that way you can say, I didn't know she did that. I didn't know she did that, or he did that. Anyways, it would be something that I'd like to read through later. I ain't gonna lie. I'm a little curious about what's going on with all my friends out there. Now, some of you, I know, because, you know, we go to church together, and even though we go to church together, I don't know what you do for a living. So if you care to share, please do. All right, so, you know, obviously some administrative stuff before I move on is make sure you're hashtagging live, hashtagging recorded. Make sure you share this out because it is good to bring more people into this incredible fold that is Pray First, where we get to talk to each other every Monday through Friday at 7 a.m. All right, on that note, I think I gotta get started reading the Message Bible. And I think there's a little bit of hesitation for me because I have to read all these. I have to read a lot of names this morning, so I'm going to read a fast. It sounds like I know what I'm doing. I can't believe that this is the first time I've had to do this. Usually, a beautiful Brandy gets to do this, and she does it so good. But here I am. I'm about ready to go. All right, guys? So, 15 minutes starts now. We are in Genesis chapter 10. This is the family tree of the sons of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. After the flood... Goodness gracious, it looks like we're about ready. Yep, we got in a lot of rain right now. Sorry about that, guys. I was just like, what is that noise? Good thing I'm in my covered patio. Porch. Okay. The sons of Japheth, Gomer, Magog, Madai, Javan, Tubal, Meshech, and Tiraz. The sons of Gomer, Ashkenaz, Riphath, Jogma. The sons of Javan, Elisha, Tarshish, Kittim, Rodaman. The seafaring peoples developed from these, each in its own place by family, each with its own language. The sons of Ham, Cush, Egypt, Put, Canaan. The sons of Cush, Seba, Havilah, Sabbath, Rama, and Sabteca. The sons of Ramna,
Shiva, Tidan. Cush also had Nimrod. He was the first great warrior on earth. He was a great hunter before God. There was a saying, like Nimrod, a great hunter.
Okay, is anyone not losing the irony of how much it's downpouring rain? So, it's downpouring rain and I'm reading about Noah. Anyways, sorry.
Okay, like Nimrod, a great hunter before God. His kingdom got its start with Babel, then Erech, Akkad, and Calneh in the country of Shinar. From there, he went up to Asshur and built Nineveh, Rabbath-ur, Calah, and Rezin between Nineveh and the great city of Calah. Egypt was ancestor to the Ludim, the Anamim, the Leoben, the Mahapha, the Bershum, the Kalshum, the region of the Philistines, hey, I can say that one, and the Kaphtorin. Canaan had Sidon, his firstborn, Heth, the Jebusites, the Amorites, the Girgashites, the Hivites, the Arkites, the Sinites, the Arvadites, the Zemarites, and the Hamathites. Later, the Canaanites spread out, going from Sidon toward Gerar as far south as Gaza, and then east all the way over to Sodom, Gomorrah, Admah, Zeboim, and onto Lasha. These are the descendants of Ham by family, language, country, and nation. Shem, the older brother of Japheth, also had sons. Shem was ancestor to all the children of Abir. The sons of Shem were Elam, Ashur, Aphrasak, Lud, and Aram. The sons of Aram are Uz, Hul, Gether, and Meshech. Arphaxad had Shelah, and Shelah had Eber. Eber had two sons, Peleg, so named because in his days the human race divided, and Joktan. Joktan had Almodad, Shelah, Harzamah, Jerah, Hadoram, Uzal, Dival, Yubal, Yemalel, Sheba, Oper, Havilah, Jobab, all sons of Joktan. Their land goes from Mesha toward Sephar as far as the mountain ranges in the east. These are the descendants of Shem by family, language, country, and nation. This is the family tree of the sons of Noah as they developed into nations and from their nations developed all across the earth after the flood. Now, at that time, the whole earth spoke the same language. It so happened they moved out of the east. They came upon a plain in the land of Shamar and settled down there. They said to one another, "Come, let's make bricks and fire them well." They used brick for stone and tar for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let's build ourselves a city and a tower that reaches heaven. Let's make ourselves famous so we won't be scattered here and there across the earth." God came down to look over the city and the tower those people had built. God took one look and said, "One people, one language. Why, this is only a first step. No telling what they'll come up with next. They'll stop at nothing. Come, we'll go down and garble the speech so they won't understand each other." Then God scattered them from there all over the world, and they had to quit building the city. That's how it came to be called Babel, because there God turned their language into Babel. From there God scattered them all over the world. This is the story of Shem. When Shem was 100 years old, he had Arphaxad. It was 2 years after the flood. After he had Arphaxad, he lived 500 more years and had other sons and daughters. When Arphaxad was 35 years old, he had Shelah. After Arphaxad was Shelah, he lived 403 more years and had other sons and daughters. When Shelah was 30 years old, he had Eber. When Shelah had Eber, he lived 403 more years and had other sons and daughters. When Eber was 34 years old, he had Peleg. After Eber had Peleg, he lived 430 more years and had other sons and daughters. When Peleg was 30 years old, he had Reu. After he had Reu, he lived 209 more years and had other sons and daughters. When Reu was 32 years old, he had Serug. After Reu had Serug, he lived 270 more years and had other sons and daughters. And when Serug was 30 years old, he had Nahor. After Nahor had Nahor, he lived 200 more years and had other sons and daughters. When Nahor was 29 years old, he had Terah. After Nahor had Terah, he lived 119 more years and had other sons and daughters. When Terah was 70 years old, he had Abram, Nahor, and Haran. Okay, I'm seeing, Michelle, that you have a prayer request up there. I'm sorry, it sidetracked me. So yes, everyone pause and pray for Michelle's prayer request. And I will read through it again, my friend. There's so much comments that's populating. I missed it. But whew, yes, and I agree, Courtney, whew, with those names. And I'm not done yet. This is the story of Terah. Terah had Abram, Nahor, and Haran. Haran had Lot. Haran died before his father Terah in the country of his family Ur of the Chaldees. Abram and Nahor each got married. Abram's wife was Sarai. Nahor's wife was Milcah, the daughters of his brother Haran. Haran had two daughters, Milcah and Iscah. Sarai was barren. She had no children. Terah took his son Abram, his grandson Lot, and Sarah his daughter-in-law, and set out with them from Ur of the Chaldees for the land of Canaan. But when they got as far as Haran, they settled down there. Terah lived 205 years. He died in Haran.
Okay, now we're getting to the fun parts of stories that we all, if you grew up with the Bible or if you've been in church any time, you've heard a lot. You've heard these stories before. I'm so curious to see what it's going to be like in the Message version. So here we go. Chapter 12. God told Abram, "Leave your country, your family, and your father's home for a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation and bless you. I'll make you famous. You'll be a blessing. I'll bless those who curse you. Those who curse you, I'll curse. All the families of the earth will be blessed through you." So Abram left just God as God said, and Lot left with him. Abram was 75 years old when he left Haran. Abram took his wife Sarai and his nephew Lot with him, along with all the possessions and people they had gotten in Haran, and set out for the land of Canaan and arrived safe and sound. Abram passed through the country as far as Shechem and the Oak of Moriah. At that time, the Canaanites have occupied the land. God appeared to Abram and said, "I will give this land to your children." Abram built an altar at the place God had appeared to him. He moved on from there to the hill country east of Bethel and pitched his tent between Bethel to the west and Ai to the east. He built an altar there and prayed to God. Abram kept moving, steadily making his way south to Negev. Then a famine came to the land. Abram went down to Egypt to live. It was a hard famine. As he drew near to Egypt, he said to his wife, "Sarah, look, we both know that you're a beautiful woman. When the Egyptians see, you're going to say, 'Aha, that's his wife,' and kill me. But they'll let you live. Do me a favor. Tell them you're my sister. Because of you, they'll welcome me and let me live." When Abram arrived in Egypt, the Egyptians took one look and saw that his wife was stunningly beautiful. Pharaoh's princes raved over her to Pharaoh. She was taken to live with Pharaoh. Because of her, Abram got along very well. He accumulated sheep and cattle, male and female donkeys, men and women servants, and camels. But God hit Pharaoh hard because of Abram's wife, Sarah. Everybody in the palace got sick. Pharaoh called for Abram. "What this that you've done to me? Why didn't you tell me that she's your wife? Why did you say she's my sister, that I'd take her as my wife? Here's your wife back. Take her and get out." Pharaoh ordered his men to get Abram out of the country. They sent him and his wife and everything he owned on their way. So Abraham left Egypt and went back to the Negev, he and his wife and everything he owned, and Lot still was with them. By now, Abram was very rich, loaded with cattle and silver and gold. He moved on the Negev, camping along the way, to Bethel, the place he had first set up his tent between Bethel and Ai, and built his first altar. Abraham prayed there to God. Lot, who was traveling with Abram, was also rich in sheep and cattle and tents, but the land couldn't support both of them. They had too many possessions. They couldn't both live there. Quarrels broke out between Abram's shepherds and Lot's shepherds. The Canaanites and the Perizzites were also living on the land at the time. So Abram said to Lot, "Let's not have fighting between us, between your shepherds and my shepherds. After all, we're family. Look around. Isn't there plenty of land out there? Let's separate. If you go left, I'll go right. If you go right, I'll go left." Lot looked. He saw the whole plain of the Jordan spread out, well watered. This was before God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. Like God's garden, like Egypt, and stretching all the way to Zoar. Lot took the whole plain of the Jordan. Lot set out to the east. That's how they came to part company, uncle and nephew. Abram settled in Canaan, and Lot settled in the cities of the plain and pitched his tent near Sodom. The people of Sodom were evil, flagrant sinners against God. After Lot separated from him, God said to Abram, "Open your eyes, look around. Look north, look south, look east and west. Everything you see, the whole land spread out before you, I will give to you and your children forever. I'll make your descendants like dust. Counting your descendants will be as impossible as counting the dust of the earth. So, on your feet, get moving. Walk through the country, its length and breadth. I'm giving it all to you." Abram moved his tents. He went and settled by the oaks of Mamre and Hebron. There he built an altar to God. You know what? I'm going to go ahead and stop right there, friends, so that they, it's easier for Pastor, I believe Brandy's up next. Pastor Brandy can start in on chapter 14 when we come back next week. I hope you guys were able to hear with all this rain behind me. Again, I think it was kind of ironic,
that we're finishing up with the story of Noah and then the floodgates of heaven open up. And I had no idea that it was going to be raining this morning. I see a lot of prayer requests coming through. Thank you so much for sharing that and letting us know so that we can come together and pray for you guys, for each other. I think it's important that we do pray for each other. Prayer is one of our greatest tools. As I'm reading through the Message Bible, you know, we finished up the New Testament, and I remember saying, I love that we have the New Testament because that's our guidebook. That tells us, yes, we have, you know, types and shadows in the Old Testament leading to when Jesus comes. And then we have the New Testament, which is, you know, God's like, here, let me show you everything you need to know. Let me show you, let me give you my word so you know whom our Jesus is. And then we have the Old Testament, and this is so much focused on, we're gonna learn so much more about the character of God. You know, as a baby Christian, I always looked at it, I'm like, oh my gosh, God was so, he was so harsh, he was so judgmental, all these things. But then the more you read the Old Testament, the more you say, Lord, give me eyes to see, the more you're gonna understand exactly how much the Old Testament shows us the character of God and how much he loves us. So stick with us as we're reading through the Old Testament, even when it comes to all this crazy genealogy and all the names. Don't tune out. You'll find that throughout the Bible, if you look in the later parts, they'll reference back to one of these names. It's important that the names are there. That's why I went ahead and read through them. Even though part of me is like, if I skip this, how many of them will know? All right, guys, this is going to be an incredible weekend at Cross Point Church. If you're local, if you can join us online, please do. Pastor Doug's message on leadership, it's challenging. And it's challenging because he's striking a nerve because he's speaking truth. He's using the word. He's using examples that God has given us to make us better leaders so we can become better disciples so we can serve him most. All right, guys, I am going to pray us out of here. Then I'm going to pause and I'm going to read through all your comments and I'm going to make sure that I'm praying for each of them as well, all right? I love you guys. I love the fact that you come here faithfully. And I'm just blessed to be able to do what I do. So Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for my friends, Lord, that come faithfully. Lord, thank you for the rain. Thank you for this day. Lord, thank you that we're able to share our prayer requests with each other, Lord, because you know that when two or more are gathered, Lord, and we're praying to you, Lord, there is power in that, Lord. So special prayer protection, special prayer of peace. No spirit but your Holy Spirit. Have your way with all my friends here today and their families as well. We love you, Lord, and we're honored that we get to love you. It's in your precious, precious name that we pray. Amen. All right, guys, enjoy your day. Kick back. I'm going to finish my cup of coffee out here, probably in the rain because it's nice and dry. How many of you guys out there actually like the sound of rain? You know, I didn't used to like it, and I'm glad there's no thunder because, oh my gosh, I don't know if you guys know this, but I have a huge startle reflex. Like, if someone says boo, anything drops, I'm like, jump a mile. So thunder is always quite funny to watch me around. My husband gets quite a few giggles at me. All right, guys. Love you guys all. See you guys later. Bye.